My name is the Reverend Nigel Irons, and it's my pleasure to welcome you to St. Edward's Church in Leek on this third Sunday after Trinity for our service of morning worship, which will begin by singing our first hymn. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen. Jesus says, "Before you offer your gift, go and be reconciled." As brothers and sisters in God's family, we come together to ask for God's forgiveness.
Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, we have sinned against you and against our neighbour, in thought and word and deed, through negligence, through weakness, through our own deliberate fault. We are truly sorry and repent of all our sins. For the sake of your Son Jesus Christ, who died for us, forgive us all that is past, and grant that we may serve you in newness of life to the glory of your name. Amen.
And so now, may God, our Heavenly Father, who forgives all who truly repent, have mercy on you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in everlasting life, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Glory to God in the highest, and peace to his people on earth. Lord God, Heavenly King, Almighty God and Father, we worship you, we give you thanks, we praise you for your glory. Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father, Lord God, Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world. Have mercy on us. You are seated at the right hand of the Father. Receive our prayer. For you alone are the Holy One. You alone are the Lord. You alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God the Father. Amen.
And the collect for today, the third Sunday after Trinity. Almighty God, you have broken the tyranny of sin and have sent the Spirit of your Son into our hearts, whereby we call you Father. Give us grace to dedicate our freedom to your service, that we and all creation may be brought to the glorious liberty of the children of God, through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who is alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
The first reading is taken from the book of Ezekiel. This is what the Sovereign Lord says: I myself will take a shoot from the very top of a cedar and plant it. I will break off a tender sprig from its topmost shoots and plant it on a high and lofty mountain. On the mountain heights of Israel, I will plant it. It will produce branches and bear fruit and become a splendid cedar. Birds of every kind will nest in it. They will find shelter in the shade of its branches. All the trees of the field will know that I, the Lord, bring down the tall tree and make the low tree grow tall. I dry up the green tree and make the dry tree flourish. I, the Lord, have spoken, and I will do it. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The second reading is from 2 Corinthians 5, 6 to 17. Therefore, we are always confident and know that as long as we are at home in the body, we are away from the Lord. For we live by faith, not by sight. We are confident, I say, and would prefer to be away from the body and at home with the Lord. So, we make it our goal to please him, whether we are at home in the body or away from it. For we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ, so that each of us may receive what is due us for the things done while in the body, whether good or bad. Since then, we know what it is to fear the Lord. We try to persuade others. What we are is plain to God, and I hope it is also plain to your conscience. We are not trying to commend ourselves to you again, but are giving you an opportunity to take pride in us, so that you can answer those who take pride in what is seen rather than what is in the heart. If we are out of our mind, as some say, it is for God. If you are in our right mind, it is for you. For Christ's love compels us, because we are convinced that one died for all, and therefore all died. And he died for all, that those who live should no longer live for themselves, but for him who died for them and was raised again. So from now on, we regard no one from a worldly point of view. Though we once regarded Christ in this way, we do so no longer. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, the new creation has come. The old has gone. The new is here. Thanks be to God.
And now we'll sing our second hymn.
I am the Lord, my people, the Lord.
Hear the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Mark.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Jesus said, "This is what the kingdom of God is like. A man scatters seed on the ground. Night and day, whether he sleeps or gets up, the seed sprouts and grows, though he does not know how. All by itself, the soil produces corn, first the stalk, then the ear, then the full grain in the ear. As soon as the grain is ripe, he puts the sickle to it, because the harvest has come." Again, he said, "What shall we say the kingdom of God is like? Or what parable shall we use to describe it? It is like a mustard seed, which is the smallest seed you plant in the ground. Yet when planted, it grows and becomes the largest of all garden plants, with such big branches that the birds of the air can perch in its shade." With many similar parables, Jesus spoke the word to them, as much as they could understand. He did not say anything to them without a parable, but when he was alone with his own disciples, he explained everything. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
And we'll just pray for Richard as he shares God's word with us. So, Father God, we thank you for revealing yourself in your living word, Jesus Christ, and in your written word in the scriptures. And we pray now that as we reflect on that written word, you will bless, guide, and inspire Richard as he shares with us what you have given to him. And that each of us will have ears to hear, minds to understand, and hearts to receive your truth. In Jesus' name, amen.
A man took his new hunting dog on a trial hunt one day. After a while, he managed to shoot a duck, and it fell on the lake. The dog walked over the water, picked up the duck, and brought it to his master. The man was stunned. He didn't know what to think. He shot another duck, and again it fell onto the lake. And again, the dog walked over the water and brought it back to his master. Hardly daring to believe his eyes and not wanting to be thought a total fool, he told no one about it. But the next day, he called his neighbor to come shooting with him. As on the previous day, he shot a duck and it fell into the lake. The dog walked over the water and got it. His neighbor didn't say a word. Several more ducks got shot that day, and each time the dog walked over the water to retrieve them. And each time the neighbor said nothing, and neither did the owner of the dog. Finally, unable to contain himself any longer, the owner asked his neighbor, "Do you notice anything strange about my dog?" "Yes," replied the neighbor, rubbing his chin and thinking a bit. "Come to think of it, I do. Your dog doesn't know how to swim." It all depends upon the way in which we look at it as to what we take from it. I don't know if you're out and about around midnight a couple of weeks ago. You would have seen the red moon. It was quite stunning. It was a long way away, but we know that the moon only shines red because the sun shines on it. The moon changes when the sun shines on it. Perhaps that's a parable for today. We only change when the sun shines on us. It was quite interesting to see it, but it's not the only phenomenon that's been in the skies in recent weeks. I don't know if you were out a few weeks ago in May, when we were told we would have a good view of the Aurora Borealis, the Northern Lights. If you went out, this is what you'd see. You could see there was something a bit strange. It wasn't perhaps quite as normal as usual, but you couldn't see the lights until you put a lens in front of them. And when you took pictures, you could see the brightness of the lights. Isn't that a parable for us? Do we see God, or do we see God at work in our world or at work in each other until we look with eyes which God has given us the filters, the lenses to see what God is doing? And I think that is the point of the parables. I remember being told in college by quite a charismatic lecturer, Jesus didn't just think up a story. He saw and observed and said, this is what the kingdom of God is like. So he saw the mustard seed. He saw the trees. He saw the men praying. He saw how the kingdom of God was and how the kingdom of God wasn't. We need to have eyes to see. I think sometimes when we listen to the reading from Paul, we think there is a difference between living by faith and living by sight. And that's not what it's saying. It's saying our sight is affected by our faith, so that we see what is going on, so that we see through the eyes of Jesus, so that as Jesus' body in this world today, we can love the unlovable. We can share a message of good news when all we hear is bad news. We can be filled with hope because there is something in Jesus that causes us or asks us to change. The former psychologist Paula Darcy, who's also an author and retreat leader, said, God comes to you disguised as your life. So if God comes to us disguised as our life, surely we should see God around us, in us, and in others. Reflecting on this, John Casey wrote, I grew up with two alcoholic parents. Honestly, I hated this part of my life. In my teen years, I was constantly angry at how they were screwing up my life. And yet, in the crucible of that misery, I worked for a summer on a concrete crew with a pastor who was in between churches. Ever so gently, this man helped me open my heart to Jesus. With my struggling parents, I needed help. And God came and walked with me in something I could not change. Over the years, I realized that the anguish I experienced in my growing up years softened my heart to be with others in their turmoil. First, it was a local church pastor. Most recently, it has been as a hospital chaplain. God has come disguised as my life. All of us are wounded. All of us face things we do not like and cannot control. Last weekend, I was visiting a lovely Jewish patient dealing with terrible hip pain. But the real pain she was experiencing was the loss of her husband 3 weeks earlier. Marilyn told me how she had prayed repeatedly that God would spare Bill, but he died. Adding to her loss is her doubt that God heard her. She is suffering now and will be for months, even years, but in time she will find God in this unwanted part of her life because God is already there. When Carl and Stephanie were in a devastating auto accident, they marveled that in the car right behind them was an intensive care nurse who provided immediate treatment that saved their lives. God comes disguised as our lives. So I'm looking for God now. My belief, my experience, is that God really does come to me disguised as my life. For healing, for the richest life possible, I need to see God in this life that is mine, whatever it brings. I'm looking and I will see. And I wonder how often we look and look to see God and how much God is the afterthought, not necessarily there. Sometimes it is more when we look back, and perhaps there is something in the parables that help us that, because it's when we tell the story, we sometimes see how perhaps God was there, coming to us in other people, bringing us relief, comfort, hope, and sometimes challenge. I wonder how confident we would be to tell our story as if God was in it, as if we ourselves were the parable. N.T. Wright, the theologian, in his book Simply Christian, says, you become like what you worship. When you gaze in awe, admiration, and wonder at something or someone, you begin to take on something of the character of the object of your worship. I wonder if we look with awe and wonder. In our house group, we've started studying the book of Esther. It's a great book. It's a great story. I'm told that when they celebrate the festival, which is associated with the Book of Esther, the Jewish festival of Purim, it's like a pantomime, and they will cheer the heroes and boo the villains. It's a book in the Bible that never mentions God. There's only one other book in the Bible that doesn't mention God, but this one doesn't mention God. In our group, it's interesting the people who make up the group. For some, it's the word of God, and that's all that matters. Somebody else was asking, is it real? Did it happen? It's such a long time ago, you can take your pick. Did it happen? Didn't it happen? And we decided in the end that the point of the story is to make us look at things with awe and wonder. At awe and wonder that God put Esther in the right place at the right time so she could be used by him. Or was she in the right place at the right time and could put her faith in God for the trials and tribulations they faced? But it was meant to make us look with awe and wonder. And do we look with awe and wonder, or do we miss things? And I wonder if that's part of the point of Jesus' parables, because as he looked round and saw the different things and said, this is what the kingdom of God is like, he was trying to encourage his followers to do the same, to see the kingdom of God in the world and the people around them. A rabbi was concerned for a young friend who was becoming worldly and materialistic. The rabbi invited him into his study and led him to the window. What do you see? He asked. There was a playground next to the house. I see children playing, the young friend answered. Then the rabbi took a little hand mirror out of his pocket and held it before the visitor's face. Tell me what you see now. I see myself, he said, wondering where this was going. Isn't it strange, the rabbi asked, that when a little silver gets between yourself and others, you see only yourself? It all depends on the way we look at things. Do we see God at work around us, or do we not? The number of people who tell me they pray while they're washing the dishes. Perhaps that must be the most holy thing to do in the whole world. Many years ago, my sister was doing her teacher training in Bangor College. She'd been 3 years in Reading, had a great time. She went to Bangor and hated it. She was in the hall of residence and we'd gone to visit her, and she'd blocked her sink. I don't know how she'd done it. I don't want to know, but she'd blocked her sink. The water ran, but had nowhere to go. So when she came to, she made some food. I can't remember what the food was. She got a bowl of water, filled it with her dishes, and washed it. You don't know my sister. My sister likes to talk. And she talks and talks. Whatever she's doing, she talks. Usually very negatively about people and situations. So while she was washing up, she was talking and talking and talking. And it was all how she hated this and didn't like that. And because she was in Bangor and didn't speak Welsh, she had to go to Rhyl to do her teacher training. So there was long days and it was, oh, everything was wrong. And she thought she'd come to the end of washing the dishes. But she couldn't pour the water down the sink because it was blocked. So using her ingenuity, she opened the window on the third story and poured it out. The next thing we heard was a crash because she hadn't quite finished washing up. So if you don't like washing up and you just want to get rid of it, throw it out of a window. But perhaps it is a parable, because when we don't pay attention to the last and the least, we just throw them out of the window and they get further broken. And perhaps the kingdom of God is like when we do things thoroughly and pay attention to what we're doing so that we can actually see God in it. I don't know if we actually believe that we walk with God, that God is with us, that God is by our side, encouraging us and nudging us with his spirit. But more often than not, people have some story which makes them stand in awe and wonder. Perhaps we need to spend more time in awe and wonder together where God is, what God is doing, and how we see God at work. We do have an election coming up. I wonder how many of you see God in the debates. Perhaps if they did it better, it would be. But part of the issues facing our country is to do with poverty and the poverty levels that are here now. I was reading about it this week, and it says, according to the Joseph Rowntree Foundation, the poverty levels now are worse than in the 1970s. I don't know if you remember the 1970s with the power cuts and the strikes and everything else that went on. Poverty in this country is worse than it was then. But it also looks forward to 2050. I don't know if you can imagine 2050, but by 2050, it is suggested that the National Health Service will be spending $9.6 billion on issues to do with obesity. But by the same year, it will be spending $19.6 billion on malnutrition. So the projected figures are that poverty levels are going to get worse. So certainly some of the denominations and some of the other agencies like the Food Bank, Trussell Trust, the big issue, the Joseph Rowntree Foundation, there's a huge list of people who are supporting the campaign to raise the issue of poverty for the election. As part of doing that, we are hosting a meeting tomorrow afternoon at 2 o'clock in Trinity, which will be led by Lindsay from the Food Bank to look at some of the issues and how we can perhaps do something to raise the issue for people in this country. But getting involved, taking on board the issues that people are facing, isn't that a parable of the kingdom of God? Perhaps we need to spend more time thinking about how God is at work through us when we're bold enough to take action. Carl Jung, the theologian, said, "If our religion is based on salvation, our chief emotions will be fear and trembling. If our religion is based on wonder, our chief emotion will be gratitude. For when we see what God has done, is doing, and will do, then perhaps we can do nothing but come in awe and wonder." Roald Dahl put it in another way. "Above all, watch with glittering eyes the whole world around you, because the greatest secrets are always hidden in the most unlikely places. Those who don't believe in magic will never find it." Perhaps those who don't believe in God will never find God unless we're prepared to show the awe and wonder God has given to us. And the reading from Ezekiel reminds us that things will change. The trees may come and go, and whatever tree that is, whether that is Israel or just an ordinary tree, there will always be a shoot where new growths will come. Do we see those new growths? Do we celebrate them? And do we stand in awe and wonder at what God is doing? That's what Jesus was trying to get the disciples to do as he saw and told stories about God's kingdom with what he saw. Amen.
We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is, seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation he came down from heaven, was incarnate from the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and was made man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory, to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic and apostolic Church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
And now we'll sing our third hymn.
Dear Heavenly Father, Lord Jesus, our brother, and gentle Holy Spirit, thank you for the plan that you had in place before you created this planet, to give each of us here the choice to become a member of your family, your planting, oaks of righteousness. Please help us to read your word wisely, to discern your voice speaking to us, and to obey what you ask for us, ask of us. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We praise you that you have placed us here in the Staffordshire Moorlands, surrounded by breathtaking countryside, trees, animals, birds, and boisterous weather. Your creation is beautiful beyond description. And we worship you, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Your ways are so different, so much more complex than ours. But Jesus, you have shown us by example, and your word teaches us how we should behave while we are living this side of heaven. Help us, Lord, to be worthy of your painful, shameful, sacrificial, and redemptive death on that cross at Golgotha, so that we can live faithfully, always in your presence, with a clear conscience and a pure heart. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
You have placed us here in a peaceful part of the world. We would use this time of peace wisely to intercede for your children throughout the world, to ask you to protect them from harm. Warfare, changing regimes, broken down family units, the lack of social checks and balances leave room for evil to creep into people's lives. Overtly and covertly, people's bodies and potential are being destroyed. Please be with our brothers and sisters in danger, whoever they may be, wherever they are. Give them your courage, boldness, and peace, so that even in extremity, they can bring grace and be a comfort to others, to your glory. Lord, in your mercy,
Hear our prayer.
Lord God, we ask that you intervene in the lives of the UK's election hopefuls. Please bring sanity and order back to our land. Fair judgment and a healthy appraisal of the problems that confront this once Christian country is needed. We ask that you confound the confusion and lawlessness which has taken root in our nation since the last war. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
In your mercy, Lord, pour your spiritual weed killer onto the strangling ivy and the suffocating brambles and poisonous weeds that have sprung up in this land. You saved us from being overrun and crushed in two world wars, Lord. Surgically remove the evils within and without. Father God, only you can make our nation great again, better than before, in spirit and in truth. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Lord, we know your heart is broken by the evils that you see, and we call on your compassion to set all men free. And we ask you to plant your new seed, a tree cutting, Lord. You are the original expert gardener. You bring the high tree low, and you make the low tree high. You dry up the green tree and make the dry tree flourish. You, the Lord, have spoken. You will accomplish it. Because of your faithful, loving kindness, raise up your banner of righteousness over this whole planet. Comfort the grieving, heal the abused and injured. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Thy will be done. Amen.
Amen.
And now we'll sing our fourth hymn. So now, may the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and in the love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father who has created us, the Son who has redeemed us, and the Holy Spirit who breathes God's life, light, and love into our hearts, rest upon you, remain with you, guard you, guide you, keep you, and strengthen you in his service today and always. Amen. Thank you for joining us for our service here today. We extend a warm welcome to you to join us again next Sunday for our all-age celebration service.